Penguin Random House Audio presents Spoken Word, A Cultural History. This is the author, Joshua Bennett. For anyone and everyone trying to get free. A note on form. Spoken Word, A Cultural History is a book of many rooms. It is a story of pulpits and hymnals and congregants' pews, secondhand microphones, dimly lit pubs, and cafe tables built for four but seating six. It is an assemblage of voices so loud the neighbors complain as the open mic runs another hour past schedule, but the authorities are never called, as this conflict from the very first is understood to be simply another part of the performance. It is a grand historical relay across the 20th and 21st centuries, a tale of chance encounters and lifelong friendships, raucous conflict and unfettered celebration acted out across 1,000 stages. At the level of genre, it is a work of narrative nonfiction arranged as a set of interwoven scenes, all of which share a single shimmering through line. The complex beginnings and widespread contemporary influence of spoken word poetry in the United States of America. There are several stops on this journey. Our story begins in New York City, between Miguel Algarin's Lower East Side living room, which served as the precursor to the New Eurekan Poets Cafe, and the pedagogical experiments of the Black Arts Movement uptown. And it eventually heads halfway across the country to the Get Me High Lounge in Chicago, Illinois, where, in a small, unruly performance venue, the first ever poetry slams on record took place. The book closes in a room that is, in a sense, many rooms at once, a space beyond space. The countless computer and smartphone screens that now serve as the medium through which millions of people experience and fall in love with spoken word for the first time. My goal in structuring the book this way is not only to paint a robust picture of how a specific performance subculture came to be one of the most influential literary genres of our age, though that is certainly a matter of great importance to me personally. Rather, my aim here is to honor its spirit in the way it shows up in the world. This book's configuration, at both the level of style and the use of the many individual voices of participants to help elaborate its arguments, is meant to echo the shape and tenor of the poetry which serves as its inspiration and condition of possibility. Thus, I will tell this story through a combination of the close reading of archival materials, autobiographical reflection, and interviews with living legends in the fields of poetry and performance. This method, like the organization of this book, emerges from my desire to relay a narrative that resembles, in flow and in form, the historical phenomena it describes. The living historical actors chronicled in this book show up in real time. They clarify and concretize and complicate the narrative. They are this book's chorus. They are its magnitude and bond. In telling the 50-year story of how several distinct collectives of poets, musicians, writers, teachers, academics, playwrights, novelists, and organizers defied expectations, were surveilled by the US government, and ultimately gave us the sound we can now hear everywhere, from mainstream radio to Broadway musicals to the underground performance venues where it all began, I hope to reclaim the political ethos and persistent dreaming of a moment that is both part of our shared past and still among us. In turning to this archive and leaving as much living, breathing room for the voices in there to speak as they will, I hope to recover the larger human vision that these writers committed their lives to. At its core, spoken word is the song of their lifelong struggle and ultimate triumph. It is an homage, in paper and ink, to an origin story that once lived only in the air and the annals of memory. A collective, atmospheric account both of what we lost and what can never, ultimately, be destroyed. Introduction, prelude to a sermon on gathering. Every historian of the multitude, the dispossessed, the subaltern, and the enslaved is forced to grapple with the power and authority of the archive and the limits it sets on what can be known, whose perspective matters, and who is endowed with the gravity and authority of historical actor. Sadia Hartman, Wayward Lives, Beautiful Experiment. When you think back over all of our past lives, only poetry could best fit the vast emptiness created by men. Malcolm X, writing to his brother, Filbert, while incarcerated in Norfolk Prison Colony in 1949. Church was the hood Juilliard to me. Frank Ocean. It was the spring semester of 2009, and I was alone in my dorm room, looking over notes from my film class on Spike Lee, trying to connect Malcolm X and Mo Better Blues in a way that felt entirely original. Blue and Exiles Below the Heavens played as loudly as my second-generation MacBook would allow. I was a newly minted double major in English and Africana Studies at the University of Pennsylvania, nearing the end of my junior year. I lived in the W.E.B. Du Bois College House, a dormitory at the edge of Penn's campus named for the philosopher, sociologist, novelist, and poet. Though Du Bois himself had a truly harrowing time as a faculty member at the university back in 1896, he was allowed neither to have an office nor to teach students during his time at Penn. The dormitory was as robust a reflection of human life on Earth as one might hope to see on a college campus. Students from all over the world, mostly black and brown, choosing to live in this place for its emphasis on social justice, the arts, and the celebration of cultural practices from across the African diaspora. It was in this uniquely boisterous environment, surrounded by the charismatic boasts of hip-hop and dance hall, the steel boom of soca and compa, hallways filled with laughter and conversation, that I looked up from my notes to see a missed call from a California area code. Whoever it was had left a voicemail message. I turned down the music and put my ear to the phone. The voice on the other side belonged to James Cass, founder and executive director of the nonprofit poetry organization Youth Speaks. Without much in the way of lead up, and with a tone of palpable joy in his voice, James had asked if I would be interested in reciting one of my poems at the White House. I would have to agree to a thorough background check and be ready to go within the next week. I can still remember looking at the phone, and then at the ceiling, and then at the desk across from my twin bed, covered with textbooks and printed notes. For a while, I just sat there, frozen. I returned James's call, and after what might have been the shortest round of small talk in my entire life, "Hi, James, it's Josh, got your message. What's going on now exactly?" We got to the matter of the voicemail. James told me that if I was interested, I would have the chance to recite my original work in the East Room alongside various literary and dramatic luminaries. He had no other information to share at the time, which was fine with me, given how strong the opening pitch was, and instructed me to stay by the phone. In a few minutes, I received a call from Stan Lathan, who laid out all the details. At this point, I had known Stan personally for a little over a year, though I was familiar with his work from a childhood spent watching it with family and friends. Over the course of his career, he had amassed directorial and production credits for Deaf Comedy Jam, Deaf Poetry, Sister Sister, and Martin, along with numerous other Black American televisual touchstones. In 2008, he produced an HBO documentary called Brave New Voices, which featured poetry slam teams from across the country as they were headed to an international youth slam competition by the same name. Back when I was a freshman at Penn, I'd earned a spot on the Philadelphia team that won the 2007 Brave New Voices title. A melange of college students from Philadelphia area schools and teenagers from around the city, with styles ranging from lyric poetry straight from the page to verses that called upon the cadence of the hip-hop styles that raised us. In 2008, we were set to return to BNV, hoping for a repeat performance. Weeks before the trip, we learned that the entire competition, as well as the road leading up to it, would be filmed by HBO. Our team was one of five that would be featured in a soon-to-be-televised documentary. For the better part of 3 months, the cameras followed us everywhere, across our respective campuses, and even to the neighborhoods we grew up in. They recorded our weekly practices, as well as our fundraising efforts on the streets of West Philadelphia. Hours spent performing poems and shifts at the intersection of 40th and Walnut, right in front of the movie theater, my red New Era fitted cap left upside down on the sidewalk to collect cash donations from passersby. After the Brave New Voices documentary aired, Stan helped create all sorts of other opportunities for me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.